Hello, everybody, and welcome to another Guitar interview. I am very, very excited today to be talking to two musicians who have inspired me recently more than any that I've come across in ages, and it's going to be a wonderful conversation. I'm here with Francois and Gianna from Putan Club and Ndox Electrique. How are you two doing?
Hello. Very well. Thank you. And you?
Excellent. It's so good to speak to you both. I've been really excited. It was about 3 or 4 weeks ago I picked up the Songlines magazine, saw a photograph and thought, interesting. These people look quite intense with the black clothes and the headless guitar, and clicked through it and I was absolutely thrilled by what I heard. I had to get in touch and kindly you've been up for talking to me. So there's so much I want to learn about you two. I guess the first thing that we should sort of cover is that this band, Ndox Electrique, is it fair to say it's an extension of Putan Club?
Hard to say. Yes and no, because Putan Club is not really a band and it's a test bench. We are trying and doing everything we want with it, and we are performing it with audience to see sonically how it was working. And years ago, while we were touring Mongolia, then a friend told us about shamanism, and Gianna and me are completely atheist. But you know, we coming back to Europe, we said, wow, these guys are incredible because they are getting high without drugs and only with music. And it happens the same with us from when we are kids. So at that time, we were touring a lot in China. And so the next tour in China, we took the time to go to Xinjiang and then starting doing research. And that was the first one, then become a movie and blah, blah, blah. Then we did other movies always about rituals. And of course, all the things that we are studying, and what is the aim? The aim is just playing with them. You know, we are not scientists, we are not researchers. Also, if now lots of universities and museums really love us for what we are doing, okay. But and then, of course, we wanted to try with people, and it was mixed with Putan Club. Then, from time to time, the people we are working with in these situations, and they are sometimes dreaming to have a band touring. And so it happens with Ifrique Electrique, and it happens again with Ndox Electrique. And so that's why, yes, it's connected with Putan Club. No, it's completely different.
Yeah, okay, that does make a lot of sense, actually. Were the other members performing together as a sort of group, and then you two collaborated with them, or has it been put together from disparate kind of different places?
It's always from one places. So the first one, so the Ifriqiya, the first band, because it's not the first movie. The first band, they were all coming from Maghreb and from the same community of Banga, from the desert south of Tunisia. This one from the Ndox, they are all coming from the Ndup ritual, that is an adorcist ritual. So it's a ritual of possession, a therapeutical ritual. So it's meant to be to heal people. Yeah, they are coming all from the same area. After that, the lineups are changing sometimes because of visa, because for the Ndox, during 3 years, the visas were refused by the Schengen area. And so we had to find also people that were already with a visa or living in Europe or not, but already with a visa. So it's always a mess about this. And let's not talk about the people from Xinjiang, China. They are not even allowed to travel to Beijing. So yeah, it's always a mess.
Yeah. Particularly, you'll notice a lot of that. I'll come back to this later on in our conversation about how international you two are and the various projects that you're a part of. I find it so inspiring, but we'll get to that. So with Ndox, and please correct me at any point if I'm wrong about this, because this is all new. My understanding is that the Ndox part of the word is Senegalese for water. So does that make the band called Water Electrique or Electric Water?
Exactly. So it's dangerous. And that's the thing. Because, you know, it's respecting what everybody is thinking about the Ndop in Senegal. Nobody in Senegal want to be part of the Ndop because the spirits are possessing you very easily. And the spirits are coming from the water. So the banks of the Senegal River and, of course, the Atlantic Sea. So that it all this was making a sense when we choose this name. Of course, it's a bit about a punkish attitude, like electrical water. Yeah,
for sure, for sure. Do you know, it's not on my questions here, but you've just sort of you've reminded me about a film. I don't know if you watched this, because for everybody watching this on YouTube, Francois and Gianna are filmmakers as well, and there's a lot of really interesting films that they have on YouTube for people to check out. So I would advise everybody after they've finished watching this to go and check them out. There is a movie from, I'm pretty sure it's from Senegal. It's set in Dakar, and it's called Atlantics. At least that's what it's called over in the UK. And it is about the ocean and about spirits. So from someone who doesn't know much about that culture, is that something that's quite prevalent, and the idea of the spiritual element and of, like, for want of a better term, like ghostly manifestations, is that something that's kind of normal for it that way?
For the Lebu community, somehow, yes. To, well, let's not call it ghost. It's mostly spirits. So it's before Islam, it's before everything, and it's animism, actually.
Mm.
Yeah, it's, you can find it a lot. Nobody will never invite you to end up ritual, but yeah, it's very common through the Lebu communities. Not, of course, the rest. It's not their culture.
Sure, sure. And because I got the record off Bandcamp, so I don't have like a sleeve or anything. I don't know anything about the lyrics. Are they sort of like traditional Senegalese chants, or is it sort of like more modern?
No, it's absolutely really antique and really true. What we do when we are doing this project, we are not touching nothing. So it's exactly what is it about? Also slowing down, accelerating, changing tonalities, or adding one time in a bar of 4/4, and then you have a five in the middle of all this, and so on and so on. We never correct nothing. Strange enough, this project, I think, is one of the most pure of the world music, you know, because somehow we hate world music business. All these bands that are fine, and I can understand this, but that are just polishing themselves for the Western market.
Mm-hmm.
This is absolutely not what we do. We are really respecting everything, and respecting also the violence of it, because the ritual is really violent when you are in the middle of 20 sabars and 200 headmistresses and so on and so on, and people that are getting crazy. Well, that's for tourists. I hate that. But trance and sacrifices, animals get killed, blood everywhere and sweat everywhere. It's very violent. And yeah, well, the music is violent, and we couldn't clean that. Mm. It would have been really something terrible and not really interesting, actually.
Yeah, that's an interesting point you bring up, actually, because as someone who, I have a bit of an issue with the term world music, because as someone from the UK, it basically means anything that's not in English. And I think that's a really not very helpful way to look at the entire planet's worth of music. But what I find is an awful lot of music is very sanitized to be palatable for a almost a coffee table type of like situation. Maybe it's because of Ladysmith, Black Mambazo, or Buena Vista Social Club, like pleasant sounding stuff, which is maybe why I found your music like such a thrill, because it's so visceral and there's so much energy. And I think the first time I listened to your band, it was that live performance when you're in the sort of the empty theater, and it's just that physicality of it all. I mean, surely is that as much a part of the performance as the musical notes?
Yeah, it has to be physical. The ritual is really physical. Everybody's touching everybody and pushing and the spitting and sometimes vomiting or bleeding on the others. You know, what we love in this kind of rituals is not the trance or the sacrifice or the violence. It's how the community take care of each other. And it's all with music, so of course we are concerned. And then that's why we were in it. It's, you know, this touristic part of all the rest of, it's terrible. And every time also we feel guilty to put this on the side of the world for everybody. But yeah, it will we will never get famous with that, you know, so it's fine.
Yeah, I understand what you mean, totally. In terms of, well, if both of you are bringing the string instrument element to that music, and I suppose there's a laptop involved somewhere, I'm not too sure. So in terms of, you have this traditional chants, this traditional rhythms that are not to be tampered with, as you said, what then becomes the process of your own the parts that you both choose to play? How do you find out and feel it out?
So wow, that's nice that you ask that, because nobody knows. It's a very long process. So first we start to do field recordings, and we are working mainly with a field recording recorded with a Zoom, a stupid Zoom, because you need to bring, you know, when we are traveling, the first law is bring very solid and very cheap instruments. So if anything is breaking or stolen, you will not cry. So Zoom is great, but you have a lot of post-production after that, you know, cleaning everything. So when the track is sonically cleaned, we put it on, we use Ableton because it's very light for computer. You can travel with Ableton everywhere, and you have almost no problem of heating or things like that. And then started the terrible. It takes like, for a record like this, it took us like 1 month and a half.
Working all day long.
Yeah, working like 12, 14 hours a day, warping. So you have your time bar and you are warping. Of course, you individuate if it's in 4/4, 6/8 or whatsoever. And then you put the point of warping on it, so the computer can talk with the ritual. Mm-hmm. And so when this very, very long and fastidious part is finished, that's the nicest, because you know, after passing months, hours and months on that, you know the music very well. You never played it, but you know it until the minimum, the second. And so you let your instinct and all the thing that you want straight on it. And usually, especially for Gianna, she's really incredible in that. The first take is the good one.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's coming that. And when she was recording the bass, she had trouble with her instrument. Because, you know, we are atheists, but something you have to believe in, or I don't know, or take care or be careful. But the spirits broke the bass. It seemed like things for tourists, but that was true. So she recorded the whole album with two strings only. But she...
And a half of the neck.
And half
Wow, really? Did the bass just literally, did it just snap?
It was the bridge that was collapsing, so I could not tuning the bass, and basically the biggest strings were completely useless.
Oh no!
I had to use just the two little ones.
Yeah.
So.
Oh no! It's interesting, because when I'm listening to the records, and when, I mean, the different from the Putan Club stuff I've checked out, I sometimes find it difficult to know when it's your bass and when it's your guitar, because, well, it's clear when it's a guitar, but a lot of Gianna, you seem to be the kind of riff player. You're taking the job of the bass player and the rhythm guitarist to some degree. And then Francois has a lot of like textural kind of like noise and stuff over the top. Is that kind of your approach?
Yeah, you got it. I mean, I love to play the bass. I do just a little starter, because once we are composing, the way I am thinking, my way to put my bass is just don't go where normally everybody is going. So just take your instrument and do whatever you want to do, not considering any law, musical law or whatever.
Sure.
So rules, no rules. And I really love play bass guitar as a guitar sometimes. I really love to do chords and just going for it. And yeah. So, yes, basically in this project, it was like also the only way I had to act.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
No other choices.
I have to add that Gianna, she's a big Lemmy fan.
Ah, so yes.
Of course, this is...
That makes a lot of sense.
Well, or Jean-Jacques Burnel as well. So she has this kind of...
It's that wild attitude with a kind of distorted bass, and it's all about... attitude's everything, right? So interesting, Gianna, when you say about how you want to kind of not play the kind of obvious thing, and then by whichever means your bass says to you, well, you can't have your low strings anymore, because they're the two that every bass player uses more than anything else, right? So it's almost like you're predestined to do something unusual when you've got that situation, isn't it?
It looks like it. But honestly, when I discovered that my bass was broken, I was completely destroyed. I was like, no way, because we spent like 1 month and a half just doing the boring part of the work on our laptops, and then suddenly I was happily ready to go for the creation point, and I was like stuck in the middle of nowhere, like, how am I supposed to put some bass if I don't have my bass working properly? But then
that's the thing about rearranging with it. But then what also we love, especially in these cases when the rituals have no harmonic instrument, so you are completely free for every harmonies as well. So of course mainly they are singing in major, but that's very nice, because then you look for the correspondent in minor and you make everything more doom. And that's great, because also for them, because you know, when we are playing then the first time the ritual with them, they are just like, what? This is not us. We didn't change nothing, but it's strange. It's another thing. It's great. And so that's funny. You know, that's, I don't know if it's really true, but that's what they say in music, that Europe was on verticality in arranging, so harmonies and so on, and the rest of the world was in rhythm. And so length of that of the music. And that's quite true. Like in the Arabic world, when you have these bars of 11, 12, or sometimes 25 and so on, that's great. They are kings of melodies, and we are a bit better on harmonies. So that's a nice way to mix. I hate, you know, again, all this world music that everybody's playing in 4/4, 6/8, and we are so happy. And it's terrible.
The rhythmic thing is the part of the Ndox Electrique music that kind of I'm having the most difficult time keeping up with as a musician. When I'm listening to what you two are doing, I can make sense of it, but everything that's around it with the rhythm players, they are playing some very unusual things. Is that difficult for you two to play along to?
Yes, that has been a nightmare, because at the first, when we were listening with them, the first recordings, and we were banging our feet in a Western way, and one of the percussion player in Ndiaga told me, hey,
where are you going there, man?
It's not here, the pulse, man, it's there. And I said, oh shit. So when everything was clean on Ableton with all the warping time, we called Ndiaga and say, please, man, could you spend 2 hours doing only with a stick the pulse? Because we're gonna arrange this like shitty Westerners. and so he did that. And until now, you really have, we really have to sing. It's not natural, but this African pulse is somewhere else.
Wow, brilliant. That's so interesting. So
yeah, that's incredible. You have more to think about the voice. The voice is always ending on their first, but it's not your first.
Yeah, right. Okay, interesting. There's quite a few notable moments, but I don't want to just start going, you know, like the bits that I like in the record. There's one particular one, and I hope I say this correctly. I didn't check it. It's Hey Ye Naline.
Yeah.
Close enough.
It's fine.
That one has, it almost sounds like you two are performing a response to the call. It's almost like they go, da-na-na-na-na, and then later on, there's this amazing, I don't know if it's both of you, or don't know if it's just Francois, just that, this huge riff comes out. Is that one of those ones where you just went and found the notes that they were singing and went, yes, I do want to actually play the same this time?
I don't know how you, because it's Gianna, I don't know how you start that, but I remember hearing the first time what you did with this bass riff at the beginning of the song, and she was playing so in something like five, or I think you're in five, and they are in four, but she's playing on two bars, dividing the times, but everything is fitting great. So let's not think about it. Nope. It's fucking great. Let's go for it. And then after that, just yes, trying to be only with the choir in the second part of the song.
Yeah.
So this is more easy, because when they are singing, we are just we are following here. And that's a huge fucking riff. And
I love it. Do you play that on a slide, the guitar part? Is it on a slide?
I tried to. It was easier with fingering, actually. You know, with really a barré, I don't know how you call that. With
one bar. Finger. Yeah.
Well, actually, with the three finger, you're getting the chord and pulling down the whole three strings, actually.
Yeah, okay,
it was
cool.
Easier and making less noise, because if not with the bottleneck, it was you had too much resonance.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's cool. It's just such a thrilling moment. And it's unless the people on YouTube have checked out that song, then those last few minutes might not make a whole lot of sense. But I suggest you check that song out, because it's amazing.
But I love when she started the bass riff, and she's doing the choir. And so she's doing on their timing, playing another timing. But we love that. You are great. Cross-minded.
Yeah.
It's very nice.
So good.
I hope that will help me on not having Alzheimer.
We've been talking about the bass malfunctioning, and I've mentioned at the beginning about how it was the headless guitar that took my interest. So I need to hear more about your bass and your guitar, the actual instruments, because these are special custom-made guitars and basses, aren't they?
Yes, right. This is my luthier. I don't know the good pronunciation in English.
Luthier?
Oh, luthier. Luthier. Yeah. Yeah, sure.
Good. Yeah.
Guitar maker,
yeah. I met him like 12 years ago in south of Italy, from where I'm from. And it was a moment in which I was willing to buy a Rickenbacker. Look at me, I'm a very fan of Lemmy. And I discovered this guy, and I told him, hey man, how much would it cost me to do a bass with you? So he gave me the price, and I said, okay, let's go for it. And he made my first bass that is not the foldable one. Mm-hmm. And then it was 4 years ago, we had to go to Australia, so it was a very long trip, and we would have buy a second extra seat for our instruments
again.
It was too much expensive, so the production asked us to find another solution. And so I called this guy and I asked him, hey man, can you, Mattia is the name, can you please build a foldable bass guitar for me? And he did it.
Yeah.
So I'm always drawing the line of the instruments the body, and then he's doing better, because he knows like how to deal with balances and that whatever. Yeah. And then that was it.
So you say foldable. Are you talking about removing the neck, or does it actually right? Yeah.
We remove it.
You have a screw behind, and so you can remove the neck with all the strings, and then you rebuild the guitar after that. And I have to say that when he built the first one for me, the first guitar, I mean, their guitars are, I have a very old Telecaster from 66.
Ooh, nice.
It was my guitar from always, from the last 40 years. Mm. And I prefer the new one that's foldable. It's, you know, it's more precise. It's like chirurgical. It's really cutting where you want to cut for this kind of music. Yeah. It's fantastic. And everybody's laughing because it's very small. It's not a full length. And but yeah, I don't care. Yeah, I mean, it's not, as everybody say, it's not the guitar that is making the music or the guitar player. It's really what you have in your mind.
Yeah.
I love the terrible guitar that has Marc Ribot, because you know, the very shitty one that hardly keeps the tuning. But I mean, Marc is so great on that. So.
Oh yeah, that's interestingly, that was one of the people I thought you might be into, Marc Ribot. It's a kind of a, I don't want to say anti-guitar, because I think, I don't even know what that means, but people who play unorthodox stuff and aren't necessarily trying to sound like Eric Clapton, right?
Even though I really like Clapton as well, no problem.
Sure,
but
sure. Really. Yeah, there's a distinction there. But with both of your guitars, is it standard tuning? Because it sounds like you guys play quite low. Are they tuned to D or C or anything like that?
My bass, yes.
She has a drop. For me, it's the normal tuning, because I'm too lazy to skip my brain somewhere. I play flamenco, so I don't want to, you know, mix up the tuning.
Yeah, for sure. In that case, I wondered if I was hearing octave devices on the guitar, but I'm probably just hearing Gianna playing the bass, right?
That's on that album of Ndox. That's what a lot of people are mistaking, guitar and bass. True.
Right.
You know, guitar wise from the last 5 years, six, maybe a bit more, I think the less you do, the best it is, the better it is. Mm. And so it's really, like you said before, like harmonies and textures.
Mm.
It's more noise. Yeah, it's more my role. Yeah. And to be as much atonal as possible, with, of course, getting in tonality and making some reverse to jazz chords and whatever in it. The ones that are sounding well with this distortion, of course, because they are not all sounding well with distortions and so on. And yeah, it's more, my role is more about the tonality and the texture, just like you said. But yeah, the big role is Gianna on that report. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Excellent. It's a thrilling sound. And it's led me to check out the Putan Club's stuff, I should say. And again, you surprised me. I shouldn't be surprised now that I'm surprised by how you approach things, but I love the notion of the two of you. I know you said Putan Club's more like a kind of collective project where there are lots of variations. So with that in mind, often what I'm seeing is footage of the two of you not on a stage, but within the audience and without amplifiers. So in fact, that's something I should address before we go on to talk about Putan Club. You two don't use amps at all, do you?
No, we don't.
No, it's always for the same rule. You have to travel very light. Because, you know, when we were start touring really a lot in the countries that we decide where to tour, like Central Asia or China or deep West Africa, well, you can ask for a backline. And I'm in love with the very old Vox AC30. They can find it. But then you lighting it up and the...
You'd laugh with it.
And, yeah, well, you have to play with it. So we were so pissed, and I was so pissed. So I start to, and if somebody would have told me this 15 years ago, I would have killed him, because I was a Taliban of the Vox. And I start looking for emulators. And then we found the one we like that's very small. It's called Ampero. It costs nothing. So if it breaks down, it's fine. It's very well connected with a left and right and jack, XLR and so on and so on. So it's great. And now we are a kind of addict. And so all our backline, you fold the guitar, you put the computer and the pedal. So all the backline is in a little backpack.
Oh, ideal. Yep, exactly. And you sound enormous when you do it. I mean, yeah. for a lot of the sounds that both of you get, even if you did have absolute like champagne Vox AC30s with, you know, the greenback speakers, you're not going to get that enormous like fuzzy distortion that you both seem to like. So you would need pedals anyway, wouldn't you?
Well, we are working on lots on the sound of pedal when we are buying it. When we bought the last one, the Little Ampero, it took us like 2-3 months to really work on sounds and how to sound like Sanho with an emulator, you know? It's an aberration. It should be not possible. It is.
Technology.
You know, yes. You can play with a Sanho sound with a guy who's playing lute, and the lute is maybe the most feeble sound in the world. Ding, and you're up.
Exactly.
And with him, and he's not amplified, and you are just, you have 2 dB of amplification, but you have the sound of the snow. So that's a great, great tool. These things are really great nowadays. They are always laughing when we go on festivals or venues.
Not the sound engineers. They are very happy because the stage, when we are playing on stage, is very silent and clean. Yeah.
And you play,
so amazing.
And you play a huge violin and stuff. But they are also laughing because we arrive with a little shit putting on the stage, and they're ha ha ha. Then a girl playing bass, ho ho ho. Then Gianna, she's plugging in, boom. And then everybody silence. And there, when we are at the back turn, they are taking pictures of what we use. I mean, it's an Ampero, it's 300 euros, and that's it.
Yeah, for sure. But what a sound. You mean, you said it yourself, it's not the instrument, it's the soul of the musician. That said, I am interested because you both use the same things. Are there, you know how with all of these effects devices, they're not really allowed to say what the real model is. So like if it was like a Marshall, they would call it a Plexi, or if it, you know, all that kind of thing. Do you have any particular pedal sound, like pedals or amps within the Ampero that you prefer for your sounds?
No, it goes directly into the board.
Aye, but like within the actual pedal, like you're choosing a distortion.
Yeah, of course.
Oh yeah, of course, yes.
I don't remember.
You know,
it was 3 years ago when I finally found my sound, and then I'm just like adding some effects, octave or whatever, very boost, nice booster or distortions, but I don't remember the amps.
Not even last year. We were recording for months in Madagascar for another ritual, but I searched for other sound.
I have a very selective memory, so sorry.
Okay. And no. For me, I'm just looking through sound and save it.
Yes.
You know, course, you start with a built-in sound that are nice, but a bit boring. But then you trick them, and yeah, you know, for these emulators, you have the notice from musician that is like this, and the real one that is like that. So of course you it's nice because you can you have so many things you can do with it, like how many electricity I'm gonna fake to bring into the fake valves, and so on and so on. So you will have different kind of harmonics and things like that, and that is interesting. Really interesting, but it takes hours and hours and hours. The only thing that is different, that so you don't have a headache. Like, you know, when you are in a electric band, rock band, and you go into the cabin, fix your sound, and for hours and hours here at home, it's 3 in the night, your neighbors are sleeping, and you are there. You're just getting it, the real one, the one that with the frequencies will not give problem with the voice for the voice or the cymbals and so on. So you can really adjust at home what you are doing in a box for hours with a terrible headaches.
Yeah, yes. Oh, I've been there for sure.
We all.
Oh, yeah, it's part of it. But I think it's kind of the future. I think what you said about how portable all this stuff is, we've all gone down five flights of stairs with like too many guitar amps to yeah, a little tiny box is going to be a lot more useful for that. So that leads me to back to the laptop question, because it seems that the laptop's involved with quite a lot of what you do live. And would I then be right in saying that would it be Ableton that you use for triggering stuff when you're playing gigs as well?
Yeah, we of course with Ableton you can decide for loops. We don't like loops, but you can also improvise with it. A bit yes, a bit no, because yeah, we have to, because we are playing like last year was 200 gigs, and so it's boring if you are doing 200 times exactly the same thing. But we are more improvising on the structure. You know, we are not big fans of the computer, and sometimes people are saying we are doing like what's it called, electronic rock, or I don't know, electro rock. I mean, why we have a computer is just because we can't afford to be touring with 15 people.
Mm-hmm.
It's very simple. And also, I hate musicians, you know. They think that just because they can do two chords, they are king of the world. And I have much more respect for the guy who made my shoes and or my guitar. I don't know how to make a guitar. And we are just normal people. It's not because we are playing music that we are. And so, and musicians always arrive late. And blah, blah, blah. I hate
that.
Also,
complaining about kilometers, the way complaining we work, about soup.
The way we work, we are anarchists, and we think that all people involved in a project have to do the same amount of work.
Mm-hmm.
Not, doesn't mean the same things, but at least working on the project. And yeah. So basically, as Putan Club, we are like doing 150 to 100 concerts per year, and we are both of us finding the concert. So if another musician is coming in the project, what the third person has supposed to do? Finding other concerts. And it's not easy to find musicians that are ready to do booking. Part of the job.
Booking, communications, and blah, blah, blah. Everything has to be done. And because also, you know, we've been working with agencies and so on. And when we were with agencies, we were playing really, really much less, and not in the countries where we wanted to. No agencies will send you to Central Asia because there's no money there.
Not even Bulgaria, man.
Not even in Bulgaria, that's true. So yeah, we love to play at Sziget Festival, and actually that was happened the last time we did Sziget. You did Sziget, and 3 days after we were playing in a pizzeria 500 kilometers from there. Who cares? And for me, for us, it's more the music that is important, and to do it with the people of the audience. The audience is the number one of the show.
Yeah.
That's so also why we play into the audience. So separate. It's not together in a nucleus at the center. It's one at each corner of the room, and the people are in the middle. This is also coming from the rituals that we're studying, you know, because at one time we say that, come on, when we are in Africa or in Asia, so studying these rituals, there's no stage.
Mm.
Let's do the same. Let's try to do the same. And it's also coming from that. You know, everything is interconnected.
And also, playing into the audience is allowing us to being all the time surprised, because you cannot repeat the same movements when you are surrounded by people. So also this is making sort that if we are playing 200 concerts per year, we are not tired of doing, because mm-hmm. it won't be never the same thing.
Thanks to the audience.
What is happening around you? Yeah. People just jumping close to you, or probably jumping close to the mics. It is a true story, and the microphones keep on going right into the shore. It's just amazing. I mean, it's lovely.
Or these people, they love to change your setup on your sound while you are playing. And you are like, because we have radio systems on the guitar, so you are 10 meters, and then suddenly your sound is changing.
Or taking your microphone and singing.
Oh, wow.
It's lovely.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. So we are improvising also because of them. And that's great.
So what I'm getting from this is that the energy is an entirely different situation from when you are on a stage and the crowd are separate from you. And there's obviously that unpredictability that you just said about people like stepping on your pedals and hitting the mic stand. But is that what makes your music so exciting? Is that because you're chasing that same sort of thrill as performers as you are writers?
This I don't know.
We cannot say
we are ourselves always very excited. But
what?
It's two different situation, really, because when you play on stage and then you have a lot of people, it's exciting. Because another thing that also the audience is always giving you back, it's really like a mirror effect. I'm not the first one to say that, but it's true. Mm-hmm. You're a bit, frantic, and the people get more frantic and give it back to you. So you are even more and blah, blah, blah. And that's very nice on a big stage. Well, you have when we played for 30,000 people, like in New Zealand, Australia, or so on, and it's great because you are blessed by the people, by the audience, and that's nice. But and then it's another story to be with them, mm-hmm. yeah, living all together with no comfort zone for nobody, and because we are moving a lot.
From my side, I mean, I agree with Francois, but I'm always missing the audience. So even if we are into big festivals like we were at the Vomad, during the sound check, I noticed that I had a way out from the stage for reaching the audience. So I went at the end of the concert. I was finishing the concert and they were on stage. Where is Gianna? We cannot see Gianna. We're still running. For reaching them back, but I mean, I prefer. And I remember when we were touring very much with Ifriki Electrique, and we were doing only big stages, big festivals. And at that point, I was very much missing to be into the audience.
Yeah,
because it's true that you are receiving back, but you're receiving back also when you are with them, even from my point of view, even more, because you are really touching people and people are touching you, and you can see their expression, you can see them smiling. But, and this is what I love, because we are not doing happy music, but people is smiling. During a workout, just dancing and smiling, and this is amazing. It's pure magic.
That was incredible. The very first time we did a very huge stages years ago with Ifriqiya, because I mean, I'm coming from a more improvised music or a kind of math rock or something like that. So nobody never danced to that, or just a bit banging and so on. And then I was on, I remember in Sinesh playing and everybody was dancing. I said, whoa, shit, there's something wrong there. I must have done something wrong with that project. Everybody's dancing.
What's happening?
But then I think it's great. Now it's the contrary. I'm really looking for dancing people. So you play in 11 or whatsoever, but you keep a kind of fake pulse that is in 2, not in 4. Boom, boom. Like in techno. That's why also people, techno people like us, because it's really next to techno. But we are counting quite all the Putan club that is odd times. It's never in 4-4. You count in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so on and so on. And that's very nice, because also that's surprising for them.
Yeah,
it's for them, for everybody. So everybody's happy.
Yeah, exactly, right. Everybody's happy. You touched on it earlier. You're kind of like, I would refer to your work ethic and the idea that you don't so much use agencies as much as you do a lot of it yourselves. And I read the manifesto that you have on your website, and it's such an interesting read. It's very truth talking. It's kind of a dispelling of the. Would you agree that it's insanely hard work to build up to the point where you're doing 200 shows a year? That can't start like that. You have to be able to the rejection, the emails, the connections? I mean, how long did it take you to get to the point where you were playing that many shows a year?
At the beginning, we were taking September and October to do only this. No weekends, no Sunday, no nothing, 12 hours a day, only booking. Now that we are playing more and more and more and more every year, sometimes you have to work after the show at 3 in the night in the hotel.
Hmm.
That's it. You now really it's time that is missing. Money is really fine. Time is really missing.
Right.
So for doing it. And you try also, and that COVID helped us a lot. The pandemic helped us a lot because we had time to won on the delay we were accumulating. So we were, suddenly we put all the balance, and we can even now more prospect really years in advance, and that's great. We love that.
Yeah,
really to be ahead.
It's crazy. I now book able to book in summer my spring tour. And this is amazing. Before COVID, I was always running out of time. And it was so unpleasant because then you cannot really do things properly in a way. So yes, somehow thanks COVID.
Yeah. We were always in urgency for the booking and also for the communication somehow.
And also, well, we, for Putan Club at least, we divided the job. So I'm in charge of basically Europe. And Francois, more UK and
UK, France, the rest of the world for the Putan and festivals.
And for the first time this year, I took a guy in Italy for helping me out with the booking, because I mean Europe can be very big if you want to tour it, all of it in only one tour. So and it's what I want to do. So but this guy, I mean. This is the first time also because every time I was asking to somebody, they were like scared to not be able to be good enough for me because they knew how many concerts I was able to book in only one tour in Italy. So people were like, no, you cannot. Or also the venues were like, hey, I always talk with Gianna. Why you're contacting me? I want to talk with her. Or well, but yes, this guy is helping me. He's very good, actually, but he's always asking me some help or some advice. And it's funny because, yes, it's a bit easier now. At least I have one country I don't have to deal with entirely. But yes, I have to say also that making the booking by ourselves is nice, because then we are really creating a connection with the venues and with the people, and then we have a lot of friends all around the globe
because we are always coming back. You know, it's not like the these French bands and because French are really terrible for that, because there is this status where you can have money every month from the state, and of course outside of France nobody is declaring you legally like in France. So they said, well, we tour outside. We've been to Italy once 12 years ago, we've been to Russia once 20 years ago, never coming back. We are always coming back, because then of course the audience is growing, the fan base is growing, and so on and so on. And lots of people are, not a lot, but some people are telling us, yeah, but you play for grassroots venues for very few money. That's not true. We are playing for all kind of money.
Everybody.
It's a balance. It's a balance. You know, there was a festival in Canada who paid us $25,000.
Wow.
Yeah. And others 12,000 and so on and so on. When we play at Guess Who, they paid a lot and so on and so on. And the day after, as I told you, we can be in a pizzeria. It's okay. Yeah. If, of course, we are not damaging the audience of the festival. And yes. Of course, asking if we can. And that's also why we can go to Africa or to Asia, because like €200 for them, sometimes it's 1 month's wage. So, of course. But I wanted to go to play in Konibadam, Tajikistan, and I succeed. And that's the only way. So,
yeah. Oh, it's incredible. I think that's all so inspiring. And it the lesson it teaches me is that if you have music you're excited by, and if you've got like a desire to connect with, I call it the audience, but you just call it people, so to connect with people, then it's really a matter of persistence more than anything else, and just making the, doing the boring shifts of emailing people and building that sort of list of connections, right?
Yeah. But as Gianna say that after 1 year, after one time, they are becoming friends, actually.
Yeah.
Promoters. And we are quite lucky, I think, as artists, because in music, assholes, real assholes, they are not a lot.
Yeah.
Actually, sincerely. Of course, we all heard about assholes in music, but beside other jobs, it's nothing. They're angels. Even the worst is an angel. I mean, when your boss is the head company of Google or whatsoever,
yeah.
These are the devils.
Yeah, but also traveling is nicer because, as François was saying, we are in a very nice context. So we just see the nice part of everywhere we are.
We are privileged.
This is wow. I mean, we a lot of times, like, I don't know, we discover new cities, very little ones, or Katowice, for example, in Poland. We love Katowice, and people from Katowice are like, it's disgusting. No, man, it's wonderful. We met a lot of nice people. Really? No, I can't believe it. I mean, it's just because we are really, really lucky, because we are in a good circuit.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we're a good team, I have to say.
It took
a long time for me, but it's a very good team, because it's very reliable. So when Gianna said, I will do that on that period, it will happen.
And also, nobody's never complaining too much kilometers between to concerts, or I don't like the venue, or the bed was so not uncomfortable. I slept too few hours, so I have a huge headache. I mean, I had that with a lot of bands in my past, and never happened with him.
Yeah, yeah. We decide to never bring nobody in holidays anymore, because that's what you are doing when you are booking for a band. There's always like 2, 3, 4 of them that are in holiday somehow. Yeah. Let's drink. Oh, look at that chick. Yeah. Let's fuck ours tonight and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. So boring. Yeah. Let's talk about music or books or art or whatsoever, but not this.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
It's not only.
Exactly. Hey, do you know, this is a total tangent, but see, just because I find you both so interesting, I want to know if you're into, like, you mentioned books. What kind of books do you like reading?
Sorry?
What kind of books we like to read?
Oh.
Poetry, a lot?
A lot of poetry, yeah. Travel books, of course. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, the one that we love, it's from Nicolas Bouvier. I don't know the translation in English, The Use of the World.
Okay.
Or to use the world, that these two guys in the, I think it was in the 50s, with no money, we went traveling until actually Central Asia, and this kind of stuff. But any kind of, but a lot of poetry.
Right.
Yeah. It's like music, actually. For example, in summer, personally, if I can choose between books, unless I have a very masterpiece, I want to read it, even just a polar, stupid one, like thriller shit or whatever, is good for me. I mean, I need to read.
It's from Elite. West of Sadness. It's really great. It's really
excellent.
Beautiful.
Excellent. I don't know. You can learn a lot from somebody just by asking them what they like reading. You know, it's nothing to do with guitars, but then so who cares? You know.
I
could talk to you two all day long. I can't, obviously, but maybe
come
we'll do this.
Really?
I'll get away from this Glasgow rain and I'll come and see the south of France where it's sunny and beautiful.
Come when you want. Even when we are not there, the neighbor will give you the key and so you can stay as long as you want. Really?
A lot of people listening.
Yeah.
I hope. These interviews.
But only Ray knows,
right,
knows the address.
Right. I didn't want to say that.
You go.
Which neighbors is giving us the key?
No, only Ray knows the address.
Yeah, don't worry. I'm not going to bring 100 people with me unless they're really, really good people.
But come when you
yeah.
want.
No, absolutely. That sounds great. So finally, to round things off, you guys are so busy with your shows. What is in the immediate future for you both?
We are back on tour. Well, we stopped touring 1 week ago. We were in Sweden, so back home, and we are back on tour in five days, for a month. Then it's becoming a ping pong tour for the fall, because we gave the Ndox Electrique to an agency, to a French agency. So it's okay, it's working very well, but you know, it's this tour that you go play 3 days, then back home, then 3 days, then back home. It's a bit boring, but it's fine. It's great. They did a nice job. Anyway, they are very nice people. The wax booking. So they are nice, because in world music, they have another way of thinking, and that's fine. Even though they are a bit too Frenchy for me, but but they are cool. And this is until December. Then from December until next July, we're on tour. You know,
with an exception, because all the touring and new movies or researches we do, Putan Club is always suffering of time for composing. Mm-hmm. So since last year, we decided that since we are going in Italy for touring in December, then January we stop in a countryside house. In the south of Italy for composing, just composing for Putan Club. And of course, going on with the booking process that is never stopping.
So more or less.
The never-ending booking process.
Now the next stop will be in August next year.
Yeah.
It's already almost booked everything. Then we have a new album coming out from Putan Club. We are not fond of making records, because we want to do it in the right way, because you can't let any label lose money on you. So you have to do it very right for them as well, just for respect their work as well. So we have a double vinyl.
Wow.
That was recorded in at the Amplifest. It's a very nice Avant Metal Festival in Portugal, very great festival, and it was recorded there. So it's a double live album from the Putan Club, but it's a collector. We will not reprint it. It's only 3,000 copies, and then after that, it's gone forever. But we have to work on communication for that anyway.
And it will be out in March.
And it will be out in March.
So after that, the long European tour will take part.
Yeah. Excellent.
And we are starting with UK, actually, this promo tour. We have 6-7 gigs in UK with that.
I have a feeling you might actually be coming to Glasgow.
I think so. I don't remember where I booked, actually.
It's on the website anyway.
Yeah, it's on the website. I know that we start with Colchester, the Colchester Art Center. It's a very, very nice place with a very nice acoustic.
And wonderful toilets. I'm not
sure. That's how you start.
You have to go there and then you tell me.
That's how you remember the different places in the world. It's just how good is the bathroom, right?
No, they have very special ones.
Yeah, okay.
That's why. You go and then you'll understand.
They've been working on it.
Excellent, excellent. Guys, it's been so nice talking to the two of you. I've had the best time. Everybody watching this should check out the music and go to the Putan Club website, because there's loads of great content, but also loads of great links to the films and the other bits and pieces that these two creative legends have been spending their time doing. Thanks again for your time. I'm sure our paths will meet again in the future, and yeah, have a great time. Thank you so much.
Thanks to you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.